Okay, so so let me outline the plan of my two talks. So the plan is as follows. So actually in this talk, I don't formally want to define Gromov-Witten invariants or any such thing. In this talk, I want to work out a concrete enumerative geometry question. So EG means enumerative geometry, and which is counting genus zero degree D curves in CP2. So this is the famous Concevich's recursion formula. I want to give you a proof of this. Proof, assuming one big fact, which I'll tell you. And the tomorrow I want to formally define moduli spaces. So today, most likely, I won't use the word Gromov-Witten invariant anywhere, although this enumerative geometry question is basically counting Gromov-Witten invariants. So tomorrow, I'll define what are moduli spaces, Gromov-Witten invariants, and then I'm hoping I can define what is quantum cohomology, and then relate with today's discussion. That is the plan. So let me start. Okay, so roughly speaking, what is enumerative geometry? Enumerative geometry is asking this question. You have certain geometric objects, you impose some constraints, and ask how many are there. Okay, so what is my setup? My setup is as follows. So what are my geometric objects? My geometric objects are, I'll be looking at maps from CP1 to CP2. And so when I say map, this is a workshop on J-Holomorphic maps, so I will not specify the adjective. Whenever I say map, I mean holomorphic maps. Okay, so map, by this I mean holomorphic maps. And I want to, of a fixed degree. Okay, so this is my setup. So if I ask you how many, say, degree 3 curves are there, obviously answer will be infinitely many. So I have to impose certain number of constraints, after which I hope that there is a finite number, and then ask how many such curves are there. Okay, so more generally, so CP1 is what? CP1 is S2 topologically, and so that is the, so S2 is a genus zero surface, that is why the name genus zero. Okay, so more generally, I could have taken here a genus G Riemann surface, looked at holomorphic curves, and more generally here, I could have had a symplectic manifold with a compatible, almost complex structure, and I could have said, let us look at J-holomorphic maps, which represent a particular homology class. That is the more general discussion, which I'm reserving for tomorrow. Okay, so these are my geometric objects, and the question, which is very easy to state, but the most of the talk I'll work out, explain how to compute this number, is the following. So which is, how many genus zero, is because CP1 has genus zero, degree D curves are there in CP2? Well, if I stop the question here, of course, there are infinitely many. So what is my constraint? My constraint is that it has to pass through a certain number of points. Let this be my constraint. That pass through the correct number of generic points. So the correct number, I'll right now just tell you what is the correct number, and later on I'll give you a heuristic justification why this is the correct number. That pass through 3D minus 1 generic points. Let us right now not worry too much about what I mean by this word generic. Okay, let's just accept this adjective generic. So let me explain why you have, give you a heuristic justification why we have 3D minus 1 here. So before I give you any justification, at least for D equal to 1, let's see that 3D minus 1 is the correct number to have. So what is this setup when D is equal to 1? I'm looking at degree 1 maps. What is another name for a degree 1 map? It is called a line. Okay. So when D is equal to 1, N1 is asking the question, how many lines are there through 2 generic points? Okay, so at least for the case of line, 3D minus 1 is the correct thing. And if you know a little bit more, for D equal to 2 also, you will see this is the correct number. So for D equal to 2, I am saying how many conics are there through 5 generic points. You might know that for conics, 5 is the correct number. Yeah, correct number of generic points. Okay, so now let me justify this. Why 3D minus 1 is the correct number of generic points. So let me now give a more concrete description, slightly more concrete description of this space. So I've already lied a little bit here. I said that I'm going to look at maps. Okay, I'm not actually going to look at maps. I'm going to look at maps modulo 1 equivalence. So let's even take the case of D equal to 1. So suppose, so CP1 is a Riemann surface. So let phi be an automorphism of the domain, which is CP1. So automorphism means a biholomorphic map from the domain to itself. Okay. So let us consider U, and let us consider U composed with phi. Well, I really should consider these two things as the same thing. Okay. So I want to look at all holomorphic maps of a given degree modulo this equivalence relation that if U is, if phi is an automorphism of the domain, U and U composed with phi are the same. Okay, this is my correct space. And so now with this equivalence relation, I'll now give you a heuristic justification why the dimension of this space of genus 0 degree T curves is a 3D minus 1 dimensional space. So this is a, so now what I'm going to say is very specific to the target being CP2. Okay. Although so far the discussion I had, you can just replace this CP2 by any symplectic manifold with a compatible almost complex structure. All this discussion holds. Okay. So what is a way to write a holomorphic degree D map from CP1 to CP2? So you can show this. So what I'm writing is definitely a holomorphic degree D map, but you can show that any holomorphic degree D map is of the form I wrote. Let's accept this fact, which is the following. So your input is an element of CP1, and your output are homogeneous degree D polynomials in two variables, such that they never simultaneously vanish. Yeah, because all of these three things should not be zero. Okay. So let us look at the dimension of this space. This is whatever, something times x to the power d, something times x to the power d minus 1 up till something times y to the power d. Okay. So how many degrees of freedom do I have here? I have d plus 1 degrees of freedom coming from this first slot. Similarly, how many degrees of freedom I have here? I have d plus 1 degrees of freedom here and d plus 1 degrees of freedom here. So very naively, it looks like I have 3 times d plus 1 degrees of freedom. Okay, this is a very naive dimension counting. But now I have to pay a little bit, I have to think a little bit. First thing I have to notice is that I'm taking an equivalence class here. Okay, this is inside CP2, not inside. This 3 times d plus 1 would have been correct if I were looking at maps inside C3. But I'm not looking inside C3, I'm looking inside CP2. So that reduces the dimension by 1. And now comes the main important point. I'm modding out by this group of automorphisms. Okay, so you can just accept this fact that the space of automorphisms of P1 is of this form. It is basically the group of Mobius transformations. A is AZ plus B upon CZ plus D. Okay, where again, A, B, C, D, it looks like there are 4 degrees of freedom, but if I scale them by the same thing, it gives me the same automorphism. Okay, so this is basically a three-dimensional, complex three-dimensional group. Okay, so that reduces the dimension further by 3. Okay, so naively, this looks like a three-dimensional space. I'm not claiming this is a manifold or anything. And so this is 3D minus 1. So naively, this is UX. And now if you accept the fact that passing through a point reduces the dimension by 1, then you'd accept that passing through 3D minus 1 generic points will give you a zero-dimensional space. And hopefully, then you can ask, what is the number? Okay. This is the heuristic justification. So now, so the goal of this talk is basically to tell you that assuming this ND is a well-defined number, how to compute this. So before I go on to explain to you how to compute ND, let me just elaborate a little bit more on why this justification is heuristic. So first of all, so you could hope that this space which I described is a manifold. Okay, so we can hope that this space of rational degree D curves in CP2 is a manifold after taking out taking that quotient, etc. And the answer is it's very close to being true, provided you get rid of some troublesome curves, which are called multiply covered curves. I'll tell you what they are later. If you exclude multiply covered curves. Okay. So let me elaborate a little bit more on this sentence. So this statement is, so this is actually a manifold. So in this case, you can probably directly see it. But more generally, how do you see this moduli space is a manifold of the correct dimension? Well, you first look at all holomorphic maps, all smooth maps. Then you define this D-bar operator. And then say holomorphic maps are the zero set of that D-bar operator. And you say that it's a manifold. I mean, you observe that it's a manifold of the correct dimension if this D-bar operator, which is a section of an infinite dimensional bundle, that thing is transverse to zero. Okay, transfers to zero as a section of an infinite dimensional bundle. So this statement is basically, so you have heard this in the earlier talk, which is related to, so there are three basic components. So this is related to, not related, this is basically transversality. Okay, you'll probably keep hearing this again and again, this thing. So the first thing is transversality. Okay. The next point is this. Is this manifold? Yes, it is. If you exclude the troublesome multiply covered curves, then yes, it is a manifold of the correct dimension. The next statement is it compact? And so because the argument you want to give here is that everything passing through a point imposes a transverse condition, you have, I mean, after making it pass through 3D minus 1 generic points, you get a zero-dimensional space, and you want to argue zero-dimensional manifold means it's a finite set. That is not correct. Zero-dimensional compact manifold is a finite set. So the question is this compact? And the answer is no. Answer is no. It is compact if you throw in some extra objects called, throw some extra curves called bubble maps define a topology on them and define this set space called M bar, and you have the Gromov compactness theorem which says this M bar is compact. M is not compact. Okay. I'll give you an example to show that the space is not compact. So in fact, you can just think of it this way. So consider this sequence of curves, which is x square, y square, t times xy. You can see what happens when t goes to 0, and you can convince yourself that the space cannot be compact even after quotienting out by that group of automorphisms. This basically converges to a pair of lines. Converges in a quote-unquote sense, because I haven't told you what convergence means. Okay, so these are the two things, transversality and compactness. So today I'm going to, so now for the remainder of the talk, I'm going to assume this question makes sense, and I'm going to tell you how to compute it, assuming one big fact, which is the third thing, which is called gluing. Okay, and then I'm hoping I'll have a little bit of time, I'll try to explain to you today heuristically how gluing is sort of similar to associativity. Tomorrow I'll try to say that more precisely. I'll define quantum cohomology and try to relate it with today's discussion and show that the gluing statement I say today is equivalent to associativity of quantum cohomology. That's my goal. Let's see if I can achieve that. Okay, any questions? All right, so let's first define a new quantity. So I have defined how nd to be the number of genus 0 degree d curves in CP2 that pass through 3d minus 1 point. Let me define something called nd hat tilde. A priori it may not be the same as nd, which is the following. It is the space of, so let me now, instead of CP1, let me draw a sphere. It is the space of honest maps from CP1 to CP2 of degree D. And I'm not modding anything out by equivalence. Okay. I'm not modding out anything by equivalence, which satisfies the following conditions. So now for convenience, let me give these points some name. So let us call them P1, P2, P3, P4. So these are points on the target. So anything on the domain, I'll denote it by the letter x1, x2, and so on. Anything on the target, I'll denote it by the letter P, P1, P2, and so on. Okay. So let us keep these points in mind when I make the definition. So the definition is as follows. I'm not going to mod out by any equivalence. So I'm U and U composed with phi are going to be two different things here. Okay, so if U and U composed with phi are both there in the set, I have to count them separately. So what is this number? It is the cardinality of the following set. So choose three of your favorite points on the domain. These three points have to be distinct. X1, X2, and X3, you can take them to be 0, 1, and infinity. If you like, take three points here and insist that the first point has to go to P1, the second point has to go to P2, and the third point has to go to P3. And what about the remaining points? What about P4, P5, and so on? Well, the rest, P4, P5, etc., they lie in the image of U. Okay, so the set which I've described is very different from the set I've described there. There I'm looking at the space of maps, modulo and equivalence. Here I'm looking at space of maps with no equivalence, but saying that a specific point on the domain, three specific points on the domain go to three specific points on the target, and the rest lie in the image. And I'm saying that, just think a little bit and you'll be able to see this, that these two numbers are actually the same. Nd tilde is actually the same as nd. Because there's a one-to-one correspondence between, so this is the cardinality of some certain set, there is a one-to-one correspondence between element here and an element there. What is the basic reason for that? The reason is that given any three points, x1, x2, x3, and x1 prime, x2 prime, and x3 prime, there is a unique Mobius transformation, a unique automorphism that takes x1 to x1 prime, x2 to x2 prime, and x3 to x3 prime. That's the basic reason. So just think about this and you'll see why this is true. Okay. Now I'll define a new object. So now instead of, so I have fixed these 3D minus 1 points on the target. So let me forget this P1, or rather let me instead think of this P1 as the intersection of two lines. Okay, so let us fix, let us fix the following objects in the target. L1, L2, L1 and L2 are two generic lines. Then you have P2, P3 and so let's say P4 till P3D minus 1. These are in the target. So L1 and L2 are two lines. P2, P3, P4 and so on are points. Okay, all in general position. And now I'll choose four distinct points on the domain. Okay, and so let me just use this notation. So x1, x2, x3 and x4. So it is the cardinality of the following set. Whatever I'm going to say is going to be false for a certain set of points, and I mean that set of points for which set for which it is false is measure zero set or whatever. I mean set for which it is true is of the right category. I mean that in that sense, same sense in which you say J for a generic J del bar is regular, all that. Questions? Okay, so you have these these are fixed, and so I want to define this number. It is the cardinality of the following set. So what is the set? So I'll look at holomorphic maps from the domain to P2 of degree D, and I want x1 to hit a line. Okay, if I set the image intersects the line, that is not saying anything, because any curve will intersect a line. Okay, I'm saying a specific point intersects a line. Okay, so u of x1 lies somewhere in L1. This is saying something. This actually reduces the dimension by one. Similarly, I want x2 to hit the second line. Sorry, not a line, it should hit L1, not a line. X1 has to hit L1, and I want x2 to hit L2. I should put a semicolon after this. So these three things are special. The rest, starting from P4, everything is of a different nature. I want x3 to hit P2, which is same. So I could have said u of x3 belongs to P2, but since P2 is a point, I might as well say it is equal to P2. And similarly, I want x4 to go to P3. And what about the rest? What about P4, P5, P3D minus 1? There's only one thing I can say, which is the rest, P4, P5, P3D minus 1, there's only one thing I can say, which is that they lie in the image. There's nothing else I could have said there. And just for the moment, accept that this is a finite number. I mean, I'm claiming that if you think a little bit, you should heuristically be able to justify to yourself why you expect this to be a finite number. But let's for the moment accept that this is a finite number. I mean, putting two lines here, two points here, and then 3D minus, three more points here, 3D minus four points here is the correct thing to do. Okay, so this is, yeah. X1, you can take X1 to be 1, X2 to be 0, and X3 to be infinity. If that makes you feel better, just do that. That might be the better thing. Yeah, they're fixed things on the domain. And even here, they're fixed for distinct point. So they're fixed but distinct. That is the only important thing. Four fixed distinct points on the domain. Yeah, so nd tilde I'm not going to use so much. That's why I didn't put too much effort into defining nd tilde. This capital nd is what I'm going to use now. So yeah. Yeah, maybe I should have put a circle outside. Yeah, right. Other questions? Okay. And so I'm going to define two more. So I'm actually not going to, even if you're not convinced this is a finite number, it doesn't really matter too much to me, because there are two more things I'll define. Those are the two things I'm actually going to use. And those two things you'll soon be convinced they are indeed finite numbers, or they ought to be finite numbers. Yes. So I'm actually not going to bother writing anything. It's, or rather, let me draw the picture here, and I'm saying the definition is almost self-explanatory. So let me put x1, x2 here, and x3, x4 here. I'm saying I actually don't, so this is the picture, or this is the notation nd with that picture. You have wedge of two circles on the first, wedge of two spheres. On the first sphere, you have x1, x2. The second sphere, you have x3, x4. And I'm going to write something. It's the cardinality of some set. And I'm saying it's basically exactly just copy paste this entire thing. Okay, except just put a different thing here. Okay, it is holomorphic maps, quote unquote, holomorphic maps. So U is holomorphic of degree D, such that the same thing happens. I don't need to repeat this. X1 goes to L1, X2 goes to L2, this one goes to P2, this one goes to P3, and the rest, P4 onwards, it lies in the image. Of course, there's something I have to explain. Yeah. What exactly do I mean by holomorphic? Holomorphic means the obvious thing. Holomorphic means that, think of U restricted to two different spheres. So each individually is a CP1. So restrict U to this CP1, it should be a holomorphic map. Restrict U to this second CP1, it should be a holomorphic map. The point where they've been joined, their values should agree naturally. And what do I mean by degree? Degree means, restricted to here it is D1 degree, and here it is D2. Degree is the sum total of the degree. D is D1 plus D2. That is what I mean by degree. Okay. So it's the most obvious thing which it could mean. Okay. This is my definition of ND, X1, X2, X3, X4. And now I definitely do not have to write down the definition of this. X1, X2. X3, X4. I'm saying it's whatever you have here, just copy paste, except this part. Just put the X2 here and X3 here. So X1 goes to L1, X2 goes to L2, X3 goes to the point two, and X4 goes to P3. Okay. So I have defined three things. One is that ND from a smooth domain, ND from this wedge of two spheres, where on the first part you have x1, and the two points on one of the sphere goes to two lines, and the two points on the second sphere go to two points, and here one of the point on each sphere goes to one line each and one point each. Okay, and the rest of the points lie in the image. Okay, and a priori, these are three different numbers. And so this is the big theorem. This is the third thing. So we saw transversality, compactness, and now comes the main theorem, which is gluing. Which is n x1, x2, x3, x4 is same as x1, x2, x3, x4, which is x1, x2, and x3, x4. This is the big theorem. And now I'm saying using this, it'll take me what? About, no, not addition. No, they are individually equal. Not addition. Each of these are equal. And so I'm saying I'll just use this equality. This is equal to this. I'll just use this equality and I'll compute what is ND. I'll determine a recursive formula for ND. This is the claim. It shouldn't take me more than 10 minutes. I think within 5 minutes I should be able to find formula for what I started with, which is ND, little ND. And so I think I will have time. After I'm done with that, I'll try to sort of give a indication why this picture should make you think of associativity. And tomorrow I'll try to say that more precisely, how this corresponds to a certain multiplication being associative. Okay, any questions? Okay, so let me draw the pictures instead. So this one has, okay, so this goes to L1, this goes to L2, this one goes to P2, and this one goes to P3. And so the second picture is more symmetric. Each one of them goes to a line, the second one goes to a line, and this one goes to a point, and this one also goes to a point. This is the more symmetric picture. Okay, so let's start with this one. This is the slightly easier. So let's start by computing this job. So x1 goes to L1, x2 goes to L2, and you have P2 and P3. Sorry. x1, x2, x3 goes to P2, and x2 goes to, x4 goes to P3. Let's start by computing this. Okay. So this will first of all be the, so how many more points are remaining? First of all, let me ask you that. So we have, how many points did we have here in the definition? We had L1, L2, P2, P3, then P4, P5 up till 3D minus 1. So how many points are, so up till here we have already reserved them for our x1, x2, x3, x4. So how many are remaining? There are 3D minus 4 of them. 3D minus 4 points are remaining. Okay, so the rest is just simple combinatorics. Okay, so first of all, just think a little bit. This is, break this curve into a degree D1 curve and a degree D2 curve and sum over all D1 and D2s such that D1 plus D2 is equal to D. Okay, so this ND will just be a sum total of all that. Okay, and this is the important point. Why is that a finite sum? Because you cannot break D as D plus 1 and minus 1. Okay, if D was degree 10, you cannot have a degree 11 curve and a degree minus 1 curve because you cannot have a holomorphic curve of degree minus 1. That is a very fortunate fact. Okay, so this is sum over all D1 plus D2 equal to D, where on the first component you have a degree D1 curve and on the second component you have a degree D2 curve. Okay, so let's now concentrate on a particular breakup. Okay, here we have degree D1, here we have degree D2. Okay, so So how many points are remaining? There are 3D minus 4 points remaining. Okay. So of these 3D minus 4 points, let's concentrate on the first curve. Okay. I've already said x3 goes to p2. Okay. And we have agreed that a genus 0 curve, a rational degree d1 curve, passes through 3d1 minus 1 points. Already I've made it pass through p2. So how many more points can it go through? Can go through 3d1 minus 2 points. Okay, because there are 3d1 minus 2 more points remaining, this p2 is already taken. Okay, and so through that I have nd1 curves. I don't know what is nd1, but whatever it is, let's write it as nd1. So on the first component, I have a degree d1 curve. Okay, I have accepted the fact that a rational curve, so a genus 0 curve of degree d goes through 3d minus 1 points. So genus 0 curve of degree d1 goes through 3d1 minus 1 points. Okay. So this curve, in order to get a finite number, this curve has to go through 3d1 minus 1 point. Okay. But already this x3 is going to through p2. Okay. There is, it has to pass through p2. So how many more points can it pass through? 3d1 minus 2 points. Okay. So choose this 3d1 minus 2 points out of these 3d minus 4 points, and you can get nd1 curves. And now you can just check, you subtract that, you get 3d2 minus 2 points, and again, indeed, you have d2 here, and that should pass through 3d2 minus 2 points, because this x4 is already going through p3. Okay, so that is consistent, and that goes through, and you can place nd2 curves there. And now comes the main thing. I have said that x1 passes, x1 has to hit L1. So where can I put L1, x1? Okay. So if I just said that the image intersects L1, that is not saying anything. I'm saying that x1 hits L1. Okay. So I've already put this curve through the correct number of points. This curve is fixed. Now it hits L1. How many points does a degree D1 curve hit a line? D1 d1 points, right? So there are d1 choices to send x1 to. And similarly, there are d2 choices to send x2 to. Okay, x2 has to hit the line L2. You have a degree d2 curve. I've already, that degree d2 curve is fixed. How many points does it hit a line, a generic line? It hits it in d2 points. So I have d2 choices for x2. It's just combinatorics, but a little, you have to be careful with the combinatorics. Okay, and now the final point. What about this nodal point? So we are looking at maps. Okay, where should I send this nodal point? Okay, this curve is identified at this point. Where do I send this nodal point to? Okay, there are d1 times d2 choices for that. We have a degree d1 curve and a degree d2 curve. How many times do they intersect? D1 times d2. Okay, so this is the number nd, this x1, x3, x2, x4. You have to think a little bit about it, but this is the basic idea. So this was the symmetric picture, and just convince yourself, these two things will not give you anything. D1 equal to 0 and D2 equal to D, and D1 equal to D and D2 equal to 0. To be on the safe side, you should try this out separately and see that it doesn't give you anything extra. It doesn't give you anything extra, and so we are fine. So I'm saying this because in the next case, one of these configurations is going to give you one extra piece, which will actually enable me to get the formula. So let me now do the, so this on its own is not of much use. Now I have to equate this with the second thing. That will give me nd. So by the way, notice that I didn't say I know what is nd1 or nd2. I just wrote it in terms of this. Questions? All right. So the other one is more interesting. So we have X1 and X2, they both go to hit lines. X3 and X4. X3 hits a point, and X4 also hits a point. So let us treat these two cases separately. So D1 and D1 plus D2 equal to D, where D1 and D2 are neither of them are equal to 0 or D. Okay. And then let us see what happens when D1 is 0 and D2 is D. And let us see what happens when D1 is D and D2 is 0. Which means that the argument I'm going to give you here doesn't apply when one of them is equal to 0. Okay. So again, as before, there are 3D minus 4 points remaining. So let's say here we have put a degree D1 curve and here we have put a degree D2 curve. So let's concentrate on this one, this degree D2 curve. Let's concentrate on this. So a degree D2 curve passes through how many points? 3D2 minus 1 point. Okay, but already I have made it pass through 2 points. X3 goes to P2, X4 goes to P3. Okay, so how many points are left? 3D2 minus 3 points. 2 points are already taken, so 3D2 minus 3 points are taken. Make it so there are ND2 curves through there. What about here? Here I'm not making it pass through any point, so this object should go through 3D1 minus 1 point. Let's check if that is consistent. Yeah, you subtract them, you get 3D1 minus 1 point. So at least we are consistent that way. So this one goes through there are ND1 curves through the remaining 3D1 minus 1 points. And now we have to keep track of the nodal point and the fact that X1 hits L1 and X2 hits L2. So X1 hits L1 means, how many choices are there for me to send X1 to? How many ever points a degree D1 curve intersects a line? So there are D1 choices for this. And how many choices do I have for X2? Again, how many points does a degree D1 curve hit a line? D1 choices. And which one should I call the nodal point? Okay, this is a degree D1 curve and a degree D2 curve. See how many points they intersect in. Each of those are choices for the nodal point. How many choices are there? D1 times D2. And I'm claiming that in this argument to hold, I'm tacitly assuming that both D1 and D2 are non-zero. I'm claiming that because one of these configurations, there's going to be an... So this, if either of them is equal to 0, this whole thing is 0. Okay, I'm saying if either D1 or D2 is equal to 0, this argument is actually wrong. Either meaning, for one of them, this argument is wrong. So let me tell you for which one it is wrong. So first, let us see what happens when D1 is equal to... D1 is equal to D and D2 is equal to 0. So suppose D1 was equal to D and D2 was equal to 0, there is indeed no contribution. D2 is equal to 0 means this, we have a constant map, and a constant map is sending X3 to one point and X4 to another point. These are generic points, so they're distinct points in particular. Okay, so there aren't any, so this doesn't contribute anything. So D2 equal to 0 and D1 equal to 0 is fine. It doesn't contribute anything. But how about this one? This D1 is equal to 0 and D2 is equal to D. I'm saying this configuration is actually going to give me something. So D1 is equal to 0 means that it is constant on this piece, and on this, the entire degree is concentrated on the second portion. Okay, so it sends X1 to a line and X2 to another line, and it's the constant map. Okay, which means it's basically sending it to the intersection of the two lines. Okay, and plus X3 it's sending to P2, X4 to P3, and all the rest of the points lie in the image. So in fact, this number is not zero, as you might think from this argument. Okay, so just see why this argument is not true when D1 is equal to 0 and D2 is equal to D. Okay, so in fact, that configuration gives you an ND. So this d10 and d2 equal to d gives you an extra nd. So it is nd plus this configuration. And now, of course, we are done, because this is equal to this. Well, we are almost done, because we have to, this is a recursive formula for nd in terms of n d primes, where d prime is less than d. So for any recursion, I have to know something. I have to know the best case of the recursion. What is the best case for the recursion? The best case for the recursion is, what is n1? I have to know n1. There is nothing here which tells me what is n1. N1 is the number of lines through two points, and that I have to know. Okay, this doesn't tell me how many lines are there through two points. I have to know that, and combined with n1 equal to 1 gives me nd for all d. So this is basically the famous Quantzowicz's recursion formula. And as you can see, assuming that gluing theorem, this is very soft combinatorics. Okay. All right, so now I have about 13 minutes. I'll now try to sort of indicate to you. So I'll not start with the definition of moduli space or Gromov-Witten invariants. I'll just try to sort of indicate to you that even if you know nothing about quantum cohomology, etc., this picture should make you think that there is some associativity hidden in the background. That is what I'll try to explain here. Yeah, so this step I did not use. I just used this much. But the statement is, all these three are the same. This written this way, it looks more looks believable, I would say, because the picture is basically this x4. So what is this picture? This picture is basically this x4 approaches x3, and suddenly another new bubble pops up and you have x3 and x4. And this one is basically your x4 approaches x2 and this new bubble. So this statement is basically saying this x4. So if your x1, x2, and x3 were, say, 0, 1, and infinity, and x4 is another complex number, this x4 is basically the cross ratio of these four complex numbers. And this statement is saying that even if you, so if x4 is distinct from 0, 1, and infinity, well, this number should not depend on x4. That is entirely believable. What this statement is saying is that this number, which a priori could be different if the cross ratio approached x2 or x1 or x3, this entire number is completely independent of the cross ratio. Okay. That's what it is. I mean, the non-trivial part of that statement being even if the cross ratio is one of the 0, 1 or infinity. Other questions? Okay. So first, let me quote-unquote talk about associativity. I shouldn't be doing that. I should first define what is quantum cohomology and then talk about associativity, but let me cheat here. So what I want to indicate here is, so think of this, look at this picture here. So you should think of this as, so this line, now start thinking of this a little bit more abstractly. Line defines a homology class, and really all these things don't really depend on that specific line. It depends on the homology class represented by a line. Okay. And the usual cohomology that you have by cohomology or homology, you have this dot product, I mean this intersection product, which is given to submanifolds or cycles. You intersect them and that's your new homology class. Okay, so given two lines in P2, you intersect them and see how many points it intersects in. That's the usual product in homology. Okay, so think of it like this. So you have, I define some number, okay, depending on some homology slash cohomology classes. You have two lines here and two points here. So this first thing which I, so this object which I have here, let me write it like this. L1 star L2. So L1 star L2 need not be a number. Okay. It's in general a cohomology class. Star P1 star P2. So if you had the ordinary cohomology product, the intersection of two points is empty, so that's zero straight away. Okay, whenever you would have something called P1 dot P2, that would be zero. But here I'm saying P1 star P2 is not zero, whatever P1 star P2 might mean. I won't even, so think of that picture like this. And the second picture, think of it in this following way, which is, in the first thing you had L1 and P2, and in the second picture, you had L2 and, not P1, what was it? P2 and P3, I was calling them, right? So L1 and P2 and P3. So you might think this is just pushing symbols, but you'll notice that if you agree that this product commutes, this expression formally is equivalent to saying that this product is associative. So, assuming, of course, that the classes commute. So one way is actually true even if you don't have a unit, but this product actually has a unit, which I'll explain tomorrow. So if you assume the thing is associative, this identity would hold. Why? Because so think of this as one thing. And this is two things, and now use associativity, write this as L1 star. So write this as L1 star, L2 star, P2 star, P3. Now interchange the bracket, write this as L1 star, L2 star, P2 star, P3. Now interchange the order. Now you have to use the commute. This is L1 star, P2 star, L2. Star P3, and then go back, and you get this. Okay. So basically, the point is, this expression which this picture which I've drawn there, that should sort of make you think of associativity. And so, now let me make one remark, which is the following. You might see this. Let I have in different context. You might see this later on, which is the following. That simply from the fact that something is associative, you get a lot of non-trivial mathematical identities. And I'll probably leave there. So that, next thing you can ask is, can you ask this same question in P1 cross P1? Can we do this in P1 cross P1? Can we do this in P1 cross P1? The correct question to ask there would be, you look at genus zero curves of by degree D1 comma D2. Okay, of by degree A comma B. Make them pass through the right number of points and ask how many are there. Does this same trick work? And the answer is a resounding yes, of course it works. Yes. Very much works. You can, combinatorics is a little bit more messy, but more or less this summing over all things becomes a little bit more messy, but yeah, sure, it works. This same statement is true. But now there is one interesting fact here. In CPN or in CP2, it doesn't have a very interesting cohomology. There is basically just point. In the middle degree, there is a line. Everything is a multiple of the line. And in top degree, there is the whole space. OK, so I said x1 passes through this. X1 passes through a line. X2 passes through another line. The remaining pass through points. OK, now I can't make these points anything more interesting. But now I seem to have a lot of choices here. OK, so in P1 cross P1, in degree 2, so I'll use the same notation for homology and cohomology. So this is generated by two things. This has P1 cross a point and point cross P1. So let's call this chap E1 and let's call this chap E2. OK. So just give me a moment. Yeah, maybe I'll just erase this statement. So let me repeat, make this whole argument by instead of putting L1, let's put E1, and instead of L2, let's put E2. That will give me a little bit more complicated looking formula for NAB. So what is NAB? It's the number of rational curves inside P1 cross P1 of by degree A comma B, which pass through the right number of points. OK, this gives me a recursive formula for NAB. Something like this. It'll be some formula looking like this. OK. And with some obvious initial geometric condition, like n1 is equal to 1, like for p2, I had an initial condition. Similarly here, with some initial data, this will give me an AB. That's it. That's the end of the story. But suppose I put, say, L1 is, say, E1 plus E2, and L2 is, say, E1 plus E2. Let's say I just did that, just for fun. I would get a completely different looking set of equations, which a priori doesn't at all look like this. Okay, you can just check that, of course, you'll get the same numbers. Similarly, I could try L1 to be, instead of L1, the first homology class could be E1, the second homology class could also be E1, or the first homology class can be E2, second homology class can also be E2. You'll get four set of equations which are highly overdetermined. Okay, and in fact, so this is done in Konsevich's paper and Konsevich-Manin's paper, and they ask the question, can you directly show that they're in fact a consistent set of equations? There better be a consistent set of equations. If this is a well-defined number, if all this theory was correct, it better be a consistent set of equations. And well, at least at the face of it, it's a non-trivial question why this first equation implies the second one, or the other way around. OK, so this may not look like such a great thing. What I want to point out is just, so this whole thing was basically making use of the fact that this product is associative. So just from this associativity, in the case of P1 cross P1, you have generated four non-trivial mathematical identities, which is that you have given a set of equations for this NAB, a highly overdetermined system of equations, which turn out to be consistent. So and that is something probably you might see later. Just from associativity, you get non-trivial facts. Non-trivial mathematical identities. So I think I'll stop here.